Welcome to Springvale Seventh-day Adventist Church online here in Melbourne, Australia. Like in previous weeks, please continue to send us your suggestions and please continue to share your comments for today. Also, please read the description down below for hymns, to read the hymns, and also to support the ministry of this church. Like in previous weeks, we have a question for today. And the question is very simply, have you comforted someone this week? Or has someone comforted you this week? Please share, and share also your verse, the favorite verse, along with what you comment. Like other times, we're going to have a word of prayer right now. Our Father in heaven, thank you so much for being with us. Please be with us. You are majestic, Lord. You are the Lord that deserves our worship, our praise. And that's why we're here today, to do that, to gather together. We don't know where we come from today. Somebody could be from overseas. Somebody could be from Australia. I'm not sure. But Lord, wherever we are, may you be with us as we worship together. Through the words, through the singing, through the prayers that we do. Please be with us today, Lord. And please forgive our sins so that you can do a work in us that we need to have done. Please, Lord, heal us and be with us today on this Sabbath day. In the name of Jesus, we ask you, amen. We're going to sing this beautiful hymn, which is hymn 216, which is in the description down below, and it's called When the Roll is Called Up Yonder. So sing along with me. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the save of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Last verse. Let us labor for the Master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, isn't it wonderful to sing to the Lord? Well, right now, we're going to have our speaker for today. And we welcome our speaker. And this is John Brereton. Thank you, John, for being with us today and delivering to us the message this morning.
Good morning, everyone. Good to be here. My name's John Brereton. I'm with the Adventist Motorcycle Ministry. You see the badge there. And Adventist Motorcycle Ministry is a ministry of Victoria in Victorian Conference. It's actually a worldwide ministry in about 21 countries around the world. We have quite a group of people who who ride with us in Victoria. You see some of them in the picture on the slide. And I'm here today as a representative of Adventist Motorcycle Ministry. Look, if you want to follow us on Facebook, Adventist Motorcycle Ministry Victoria, look us up. Or if you've got a bike, you want to join us, no problem at all. Love to hear from you. I've got a question for you. Do you believe we're living in the last days? It's a good question. If you do believe we're living in the last days, why do you believe we're living in the last days? If this was a normal situation and I was standing in front of you, I would ask you and get some answers. But I guess you're answering these in your head as I'm saying these questions. The reason I believe we're living in the last days is, number one, evidence of prophecy being fulfilled. And every day, prophecies are being fulfilled. Daniel chapter 2, chapter 7, chapter 9, Revelation 13, Revelation chapter 14. Some of these different important prophetic chapters are being fulfilled right before our eyes. The second reason I believe we're living in the last days is the signs of Christ coming. And you can read about these in Matthew 24, Luke 21, Mark 13. And Jesus talked about some of these signs. We don't know the day or the hour, but we know that it's near because of these signs. There would be wars and famines and earthquakes and different things. I lived in Christchurch for 2 years back in the early 90s. We never had one earthquake in 2 years. Since the big one in 2011, there's been 11,200 earthquakes. All these things will increase. Some of the signs of the times. These all tell me that Jesus is coming very, very soon. We are living in the last days of this world's history. I didn't grow up in the Adventist church. I wasn't baptized till I was 29. And when I started to read the Bible, I found that there was two remnants in the book of Revelation in the last days. Two remnants. That's what we're going to look at today, the two remnants in the last days. The first remnant I found in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 17. Well, the whole of chapter 12 is really a history of God's church from before the birth of Jesus down until the day in which we live. And the last verse in Revelation 12, verse 17 says this: "And the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God, have the testimony of Jesus Christ." The first thing I discovered when I started to read the Bible as an adult for the first time was that the book of Revelation, some of these prophecies are filled with symbols that I didn't understand. For example, I didn't know who the dragon was. And I asked a number of people and I got a number of different answers. But I soon discovered that the Bible interprets itself. In one place, if it doesn't explain itself, it will explain itself in another place. For example, if you want to find out who the dragon is, go to the same chapter, chapter 12, but verse 9, which says this: "And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan." Beyond any shadow of a doubt, where it says dragon in that context, that's the devil. And the devil or the dragon or the devil was wroth or angry with the woman. Who's the woman? Again, I look to the Bible to interpret itself. We don't have to guess. It says in Jeremiah 6:2, there's a number of different chapter or verses you can look at, but Jeremiah 6:2 says this: "I have likened the daughter of Zion," that's God's church, "to a comely and delicate woman," to a beautiful and delicate woman. Again, 2 John 1:1. John, the disciple, is writing a letter, and he's saying the elder, that's him, he's the elder, unto the elect lady. So where it says woman there, that's God's church. So the devil's angry with God's church, and he went to make war with the remnant of her seed. I didn't know what the remnant meant in this context, so I looked up the dictionary, and Webster's dictionary says remnant equals remainder of her seed. And some of the newer translations, I'm using the King James, some of the newer translations have offspring. So the devil is angry with God's church and went to make war with the remainder of her seed. This is the first remnant. And so there's no way you can miss out who this remnant is. God has given us two identifying marks in the same verse. The first identifying mark says, "which keep the commandments of God." Now, Doug Batchelor, in one of his sermons, mentioned that there are 30,000 different Christian churches you can join in the world. 30,000. And all of these churches have the commandments of God. This is a picture I took in the US somewhere two-meter high set of commandments on the footpath. And when you look at them, they're all mucked up. The fourth commandment is not the Sabbath commandment. It's honor your father and mother. So 30,000 churches have these commandments, but this remnant church keeps the commandments. It doesn't mean that they're stronger or they're more determined or they've got more grit. What it really means is this, that they have such a close relationship with Jesus that he lives in their heart. And wherever Jesus is, there's commandment keeping. It's as simple as that. Jesus, their love for Jesus empowers them day by day through his power to keep the commandments. This is the first identifying mark. There's a second identifying mark that says, and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. What's the testimony of Jesus Christ? Again, let's see the Bible interpret itself. Revelation 19:10 says this, the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. So this commandment-keeping church, the one that the devil's angry with in the last day, this remnant, this remainder, this last handful of people, God's faithful people who keep his commandments, they have the spirit of prophecy amongst them. And I believe that's perfectly fulfilled through the writings and life of Ellen G. White. But as I read through the Bible, as a new Christian, I found that there was a second remnant in the last days. And this is you find that in Revelation chapter 18. And Revelation 18, verse 1 says this, and after these things I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lighted with his glory. This is John, the last surviving disciple, writing this because he had a vision. He had a vision and wrote them down, just as Ellen White had visions and wrote them down in books like The Great Controversy, Desire of Ages, etc. John, the last surviving disciple, had visions and wrote them down. And he says here, and after these things, I saw another angel, because in Revelation 14, in a previous vision, he saw three angels. And he says, I saw another angel come down from heaven. Just pause here for a second, because I want to just let you know, from my study of the Bible, this is the last message to be given to the planet before Jesus comes back. Let that sink in. The last message before Jesus comes back. Do you think it's going to be important? Do you think it's going to go... Well, it says here, let me just read that verse one again. Another angel come down from heaven having great power. The last message, God has put everything into this last message to warn the people that Jesus is coming back. And the earth, the entire earth was lighted with his glory. Verse two, he cried mightily with a strong voice saying, Babylon the great has fallen, has fallen, and has become the habitation of devils and the hold of every foul spirit and a cage for every unclean and hateful bird. Well, I was stumped. What is Babylon? I looked up, I found the city of Babylon, the one that Daniel went to as a boy, about 500 years before Jesus was born, I guess. And it wasn't that Babylon, because that Babylon doesn't exist today. It's just rubble. The only other reference to Babylon I could find was the Tower of Babel. And when I read about the Tower of Babel, how after the flood, God said there'll be no more worldwide flood, put the rainbow in the sky, people didn't believe him. And they built a tower to escape the flood that wasn't coming. In those days, the Bible tells us there was only one language on the whole planet, and God confused their languages. And when you think about it, this is a perfect example of the Christian churches today. They're confused, not confused with languages, they're confused with their doctrines, and they cannot finish the work that God has given the church to do. Perfect. Description, calling it Babylon today. Come down to verse 4. It says in verse 4, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people. That her is Babylon, of course. Come out of Babylon, my people. I thought, how can God have his people in Babylon? When you go back to verse 2, it's a cage of every foul spirit, all the unclean and hateful bird. It's a filthy place, full of all the doctrines of the devil. How can God have his people in Babylon? Is that true? I believe it is. Let me illustrate with a story. For 36 years, I was a literature evangelist, working in a number of different capacities around the world, actually. And one time I was a literature evangelist in Toronto, between Sydney and Newcastle, the little town of Toronto on the lakes there. And I was knocking on doors, and the custom is you knock on the door, and if no one answers, you wait for a minute or so, then you knock again, another wait for another maybe 30 seconds, and then you leave and put a sign of the times in the letterbox and go to the next door. Well, I knocked the first time, knocked the second time, was walking out when suddenly the door opened. And I spun around, this is what I saw. I saw a lady there in her mid-40s. She'd obviously just woken up. Even though it was mid-afternoon, she'd just woken up. She had a brown, full-length down to the ground, brown dressing gown on. Her hair was a mess. It had just fallen over in the night. She'd just woken up. She had no makeup on, and she had lit a cigarette. So she must have heard the knock, sort of crawled out of bed, lit the cigarette, and stumbled to the door. And she's standing there coughing on this first cigarette as I walked back to her. And I said, good morning. And she said, what do you want? And I said, and in my chirpiest voice, I said, I'm visiting all the homes in the area. And she said, look, cut to the chase. Which church are you from? And I said, Seventh-day Adventist. She said, come on in. I thought, this is a good sign. So I followed her down this long hallway, and she's smoking this cigarette, coughing this, this first cigarette of the day, and the smoke's billowing over her head, and I'm trying to dodge this stuff. I didn't want to breathe it. I used to smoke. I don't want to smoke anymore. About halfway down this long hallway, she stopped and she spun around, and this is what she said. She said, you Seventh-day Adventist, I really admire your health message, she said as she coughed. I didn't say a word. I'm thinking this is going to be a good one. And then she turned around and kept walking, and I followed her, kept following her. When she got to the end of the hallway, she stopped and spun around again. And she said, I'm going to shock you. And I'm thinking, wow, it's going to be great. She said, I'm a reverend with the Uniting Church. I thought, wow, I've never met a lady reverend before. This is going to be fantastic. So we sat at the table, and she told me her name was Reverend Anne. That was her name. And this is her church. Even though this is in New South Wales, up near Newcastle, she had the largest, I've got the largest Uniting Church in Melbourne. And this is a picture of her church. And we sat down at the table, and she told me that this was her sister's house we're in. Her sister had cancer. And she had to come and visit her sister before her sister died. And she said that, I'm so broke, I had to go and get a credit card to pay for the airfare. I've never had a credit card before, never used a credit card before. I'm so broke, I had to get a credit card to pay for the airfare to fly up to Newcastle to visit my sister. And a little voice said to me, plain as day, you're wasting your time here. She's got no money. Go next door. Whose voice is that? That's the devil's voice. Another voice said to me, plain as day, trust in me with all your heart. Lean not onto your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge me, and I will direct your path. Now, there's a couple of things I've learnt over the years, is that when God speaks, he speaks in a very small voice, which I just don't understand, because he's the incredible God that built the universe, that goes forever. He's got this little tiny voice. The other thing I've discovered is that the devil copies God's voice, and many people get confused. The only way you can tell it's God's voice is if it speaks according to the Bible. If it doesn't, there's no light in it. That's what I've discovered. So I knew that this was from the devil, because I'm not there to get money. I'm there to help her find Jesus, to take her to the next step. And so I sat down and I started to present a set of five medical books or health books. And I went through the part on how to give up smoking. And Reverend Ann said, I love these books. I need these books. Then I pulled out a spiritual book called Today, Tomorrow, I Knew by Arthur Maxwell. And I said, this is a great book too. It's part of the set. And she said, when she found it was a Christian book, she said, I'm not interested. I do not want books on theology. I said, Anne, it's not a book on theology. It's a book about Jesus. She said, I'm not interested, but I want those ones. And then on this dining room table, round table, was her handbag. And she leaned across, big handbag. Ladies have got great big handbags. And she leaned across and grabbed it and dragged it to her and opened it up. And she pulled out something that absolutely shocked me. She pulled out something that looked like this. It was the greatest roll of money I've ever seen in my life. It was so big, she rolled it across the table to me, and my eyes popped out. First of all, I'd never seen so much money in my life. And second, she said she was broke. And she rolled it to me, and I stopped it, and I looked at the money, I looked at her, and I looked at the money, I looked back at her, and she said, you're probably wondering where I got this money from, because I said I was broke. I said, yeah, well, I am. She said, before I left Melbourne, my church had a special offering. They knew I was broke. They knew I was going to visit my sister. This is the offering. They said, Anne, Reverend Anne, this is the offering. We want you to take it and keep it. It's yours to do whatever you like with it. May God bless you on your trip. She said, is there enough money there to buy these books? And I picked up the money and I said, for this amount of money, you can have my books and my bag and my car and probably my house too. There's so much money there. So I took off the rubber band and took off two or three notes to pay for the books, put the rubber band back on and rolled it back to her. And I'm writing this receipt up. And as the money went back to her, she stopped it and put a hand on it. And as I'm writing this receipt, I can see her out of the corner of my eye. And she stopped the money and she's just looking at it for about a minute. It was a long while. She's just staring at this money and I'm writing this receipt. And after about a minute, she rolled it back to me. And I stopped it. And I am totally confused now. I'm looking at the money with a confused look on my face and looking at her. And these were her exact words. I'll never forget them. "Do you take donations?" I said, "What do you mean?" She said, "I want you to have it all." I said, "Why?" She said, "Because you're going door to door preparing people for Jesus to come. My church is not doing that. When you find people who need these books but can't afford them, use this money to pay for them." And the little voice said, "I told you so. Trust me, trust me." Then that little voice said this, clear as a bell, "Give her a book for free. She's been kind, give her a book." So I pulled out two books, Desire of Ages and Today, Tomorrow, New. I said, "Anne, look, you've been so kind. I want to give you a gift. Which of these would you like?" And she burst into tears. I mean, not just a little. I mean, she burst into tears. So much so, I thought I offended her. And I said, "Have I offended you?" She said, "No." She said, "God sent you to my home, and there's a message in one of these books that God wants me to have, but I don't know which book." And she raised her hand, closed her eyes, and said this prayer, "Lord, please, whatever book I'm supposed to have, help my hand touch it first." And she dropped her hand down and landed on the green book. And she took that book. We prayed together. She said, "When you move to Melbourne, whenever you come to Melbourne, come and preach in my church." Look at this quote from Great Controversy, page 390. Check it out. It says, "Notwithstanding the spiritual darkness and alienation from God that exists in the church which constitute Babylon, the great body of Christ's true followers are still found in their communion." The great body, this is saying Ellen White's had a vision, and the great body, the majority of Christ's believers are still in Babylon. The majority of them are still in there, Catholics. Some are Buddhists, some are Muslims, some are Presbyterians. The great body is still in there. The question is, how are these people to be warned? How are they to know about God and how to come out? How are they to be warned? One of my favorite books from Ellen White is Cole Porter Ministry. Now listen to this quote. Page 4, it says, "In a large degree, through our publishing houses," she really means through literature here, that's what she's meaning, in a large degree through our publishing houses is to be accomplished the work of that other angel who comes down from heaven having great power and who lightens the earth with his glory. That is a direct quote from Revelation 18:1-4. What she's saying is here is God's last message, this most important message, to prepare people for Jesus to come back, to get everybody ready who's going to be ready. This last angel, this last message, this last warning of the world is to be accomplished by literature, books, magazines, tracts in the hand of the first remnant as they distribute them around their neighborhood and friends and family and wherever. A large degree through our publishing houses, large degree, the majority of people who are converted. I'm standing here today as a result of a book that Today, Tomorrow, New changed my life when I read it. I was a drug addict, changed my life. Yes. Let me just share how literature works. It's not hard to give literature out. This is what I'm talking about. I'm going to challenge you to give literature out. I'm still giving out about 200 books a week, even through the virus. People are taking them and I'm all types of stuff. This is a story that just illustrates how easy it is to give literature out, how God can use you, even if you have no experience. God doesn't need experience. He just needs someone to be available. He wants you to be available. If you're available, he will bless and use you. I call this the postman story. It happened when I was first converted. So this is back in the early 80s, 82, I think, something like that. I was living north of Sydney, and I went to this little church here called Canwell Church. Some of you may know it, up near Tookley, north of Wyong. And just a small church. And my first day to church, I put on my best clothes, pair of stubby shorts, the most embarrassing fashion ever invented, a pair of thongs, and I think it was singlet or something. And I walked in, and that was the days everyone wore suits and stuff. And I walked in, and I sat in the back row. I'd never been to church before in my life. I read this book, changed my life. I already believed in the Sabbath. I was keeping the Sabbath. I believed all the doctrines of the Seventh-day Adventist Church in a very basic way. I've even become a vegetarian. sitting in that back of that church, I'm thinking, if these people do not like the way I'm dressed, I was going to punch them, and I reckon I could make it to my car and take off before they beat me up. That's what I was thinking. Well, of course, they didn't say anything about the way I'm dressed. It doesn't matter. If whoever walks through that door, they should be welcome, no matter how they're dressed, no matter who they are, no matter what they've done. And that's what these folk were like. They were lovely, lovely people. They just loved us. And we were baptized, etc. Then the head elder of the church heard I was out of work. Now, I just did 2.5 years, and a long job. I was having a bit of a break, but he heard I was out of work, and he offered me a job. And I didn't want a job. I wanted to have 2 or 3 months off. I hadn't had any time off for 2.5 years. And he offered me a job in his factory. And I couldn't say no, because he was such a lovely guy. He was just a gem of a man. Arthur Keeler was his name. And he had a family business, just a trussing business, made frames and trusses for houses. And I worked for him for 1 year as I was studying to be baptized. And I used to work that blue saw. Sorry, go back. The blue saw in the corner. That was my sort of work for a year. And under the saw, I knew how important literature was, even though I didn't understand anything at all, really. And under the saw, I had 3 boxes. A box of great controversies, box of steps to Christ, and box of signs of the times. Whoever came into that factory got something. And Arthur didn't mind. Arthur Keeler didn't mind. It was his factory. But he was a very evangelistic person. But he was busy running his business, so he saw me doing it, and he was happy. And everyone got something except for the postman. The postman, my saw was just around the corner to the left there. And the postman used to come past every day at different times on his little red motorbike, something like that, I guess. And he used to have a bundle of money, just throw it in and ride off. And I chased the guy, and I could never catch him. It just wasn't working. And I was getting so frustrated. Man, I couldn't sleep at night. I couldn't catch this guy. And I had to catch him. So I come up with a plan. As soon as I saw the mail come through the door, I'd have a sign of the times in my belt. Already there, had it there for a couple of hours, waiting for him to come. As soon as I saw the mail come through the door, drop everything and chase him down the highway. What's it? The Pacific Highway. It's on the Pacific Highway. And sure enough, the next day, the mail come through, flying through, and I just dropped and run down the highway. I pulled the signs out. It was when they were big in those days. I pulled the signs out, and I'm waving it. And he's driving along his motorbike, taking off, and he looked in his rear vision mirror, and he saw me. And he's done a big U-turn and come back. And I put the signs of the time in with his mail, and I said these incredible words. You should memorize them because they work every time. I said, "This is for you." And I shoved it in with his mail, and he took off. And I thought, "You beauty, I haven't got it. I've got him. I can sleep tonight. Yay!" The next day, I'm working my saw. I saw him ride his motorbike and park it, put his kickstand down, take his helmet off, put it on the mirror. And the little voice said to me, "He's coming to fight you. He's found something in that magazine he doesn't like. He's coming to fight you." I didn't know about the voices in those days. And he's walking in, and I'm bracing to fight this guy. And he walked in, and he says, "Are you a Christian?" I said, "Yeah. Want to make something of it?" and he said, "No, no, no." He said, "I've been praying that God would lead me to a Christian." He said, "I've got a drug problem. My wife's fired. Our marriage is a mess." He said, "I've been praying that God would lead me to someone. Can you help me?" I went into panic mode. I'd been going to church about 2 weeks at this stage. I went into panic mode. And I went box number two, and I picked up box one, box two. I picked up a steps to Christ. I said, "This is for you." And I shoved it in with his mail, and he took off. Oh, phew, that was close. I'm almost at the talk. Next day he came back, parked his bike, come in. He said, "Look, I read that entire book last night. It's fantastic. Can you help me?" Panic mode again. Box one, box two, box three. Great controversy. Take this. Put him with his mail. Took off. Next day he come back. He said, "I've been up all night reading this book." He said, "If I adjust my post run, can we have lunch together and study the Bible together on this stack of wood there?" I said, "Sure." And so he did that. And we studied the Bible on that wood for months. And that pile of timber just inside that door. You know, and I've got to tell you, this is where my theology was at. The pastor I was studying with, he said, "John, when you find something in the Bible you don't understand, write it down. When I come around Thursday nights for your study, you can ask me then." So Pastor Frank Braden came around on the Thursday night. I said, "Pastor Braden, I found something I don't understand, a word in the Bible." He said, "What is it?" I said, "It's tithy." He said, "Tithy? Show me." And I pointed to the word. He said, "That's tithe," he said, with a bit of a smile on his face. That was my theology. You know, I am studying with this postman. His name's Michael. Him and I were studying on this pile of wood for months. You know, and Michael today, him and his wife and his cousin Tony and Tina, the four of them, Tony was a heroin addict. The four of them were baptized together in Campbell Church. And Michael today works for Sanitarium as a sanitarium rep in New South Wales. You know, it says more than 1,000 we will be converted in one day. Cole put a ministry page 151. More than 1,000 will be converted in one day. Ellen White had a vision in 1885. In the vision, she saw more than 1,000 being converted every day, 7,000 on average every week being converted into the Adventist Church. This was back in 1885 when our church consisted of about 2,000 people, mainly in the northeast of the United States. And she had a vision. At some stage in the future, more than 1,000 will soon be converted in one day, most of whom will trace their first convictions to the reading of our publications. And today, notice most of whom, the majority of people will be converted, who's converted today, trace their convictions to reading of our publications, just like me. Today, there's around 21,000 people baptized into the Adventist Church every Sabbath on average. And I've been to giant baptisms. There's one in Africa. 40,000 people were baptized in the Adventist Church on one Sabbath. One I went to in Cambodia. Seven pastors in Cambodia, they baptized all day from 9 o'clock till up till about six, just baptizing all day, the seven pastors. No Sabbath school, no church service, just baptizing all day. Lost count how many. Most of whom will trace their first convictions to the reading of our publication. I want to challenge you to distribute literature. You know, by distributing literature, you're preparing people for Jesus to come. And just as important, you're preparing yourself, because unless you share your faith, well, look at this text here, Revelation 12:11. It says, "And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony." This is Revelation 12, where we looked at verse 17 before. And it says there, "And they," that's the remnant. In this context, that's the remnant. "And they," the remnant, "overcame him," the devil, "by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony." When I first read that, I thought there's a mistake. Why is there a comma after Lamb? Isn't the blood of the Lamb good enough? Why is it the blood of the Lamb plus something? I prayed and prayed and prayed till finally God gave me the answer. God knows, unless the remnant share their faith, unless they share their testimony, unless they're active, working members of the church, if they're nominal, they eventually won't rely on the blood of the Lamb. Only when we share our testimony do we really cling to Jesus. So this is my challenge for you. Share Jesus. Now, there's other ways to do it without literature, I guess, but I find literature the most powerful way. Every time you leave a book, every time you leave a tract, every time you leave a magazine, it's an opportunity for God to use that when he sees fit. May God bless each one of us as we prepare for Jesus to come. God bless.
Thank you, John, for those wonderful words today. We're going to do our last hymn, and that is hymn 522, which you can also see in the description down below. And it's called "My Hope is Built on Nothing Less." Let's sing.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, clad in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand.
Let us have a word of prayer. Our Father, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for everything you're doing for us today. We thank you for your word. We thank you for John Brereton's testimony and also for his words today. We thank you for the worship that we have been able to do for you. Lord, today we just want to ask you to continue with us, to continue changing us, Lord, so that we can be prepared when you come. And so that as we wait for your return, may you help us live the life that you want us to live today, tomorrow, and the day after, until you return. We ask you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, like other weeks, please continue to send us your suggestions as to how we can do things better. And of course, continue to provide comments for today. Don't stop. Even though we're just about to finish this service, continue to encourage others. And also, please be encouraged by God's word, by his presence in your life. And of course, if you would like to support the ministry of the Springvale Seventh-day Adventist Church, don't forget to read the description down below and follow the directions. There is only one more thing I'd like to say to everyone here today, and that is God bless you and keep you safe. Amen.